It's another Football Friday on News OK Live. I'm Mike Sherman, sports editor of the Oklahoma, joined here by our OU and OSU coverage team from our home in Oklahoma City, columnist Jenny Carlson.
Hey, everybody.
OSU beat writer Kyle Fredrickson.
Howdy.
And OU beat writer Ryan Aber.
Good morning.
Guys, the Oklahoma Sooners have the week off, but the Oklahoma State Cowboys are getting ready for an interesting game, 2:30, homecoming game against West Virginia Saturday in Stillwater. And the subplot or the plot of this game, Kyle, is the OSU offense. The way we've been phrasing all week is something like, where is my offense and what have you done with it? I guess that's the question for Oklahoma State fans. You're going to answer tomorrow. Give us a sneak peek on what you'll be writing for the Oklahoma pregame.
Right. You know, and obviously the offense's struggles have been well documented at this point, and that makes it story worthy. But we're also talking about a game where the Cowboys are going against the guy who installed basically what they're still running today. You know, Dane Holgorsen comes into Stillwater in 2010. You know, all of a sudden we're seeing shotgun every snap, as many as three running backs in the backfield, really kind of reinventing what the Cowboys want to accomplish and how they want to accomplish it. And even through the years as Holgorsen has left, when Todd Monken and Mike Yurcich came in, they both said, listen, I've got some ideas, but I'm not trying to change what you guys are doing. And it's obviously been very successful with the guys they've just been able to plug in. You know, after Brandon Whedon, you know, Clint Shelf comes in and it's the same system, the drop back passer, you know, with a lot of weapons around him, a simple playbook and a lot of those options that go off of every single play. And then all of a sudden this year, once the Cowboys hit conference play, we really started to see this offense not function like it has in a number of years. And so when you look at all the factors that goes into it, you know, youth is obviously the biggest thing, and it starts with the offensive line, especially at center. You know, the center position in this offense, they kind of call as the field manager. He has to identify all the blitz packages and everything that's coming. And last week, they had a walk-on freshman playing that position. So that should tell you everything you need to know kind of about where it all starts. I think the good news when OSU fans are thinking about this offense and the struggles that it has, the Cowboys have to be banking on these guys just continuing to get better. You know, that this might just be one of those seasons where they have to take their thumps when they have to, is learning experiences, and hope that pays off down the road, because you figure they have the pieces in place to be a successful offense if these guys continue to grow. But this season, I think no matter who you have in that quarterback, just the chances for success are not as going to be as high just because of the youth and all the inexperience they have.
Jenny, we're always talking about Oklahoma State's offense and how really it hasn't mattered who was at quarterback, who was doing the coordinating. The Cowboys were on an upward plane as far as their production offensively, been among the best in the country almost since the moment, you know, since Mike Gundy's second season. The first season was a little rough, the Al Pena years, I like to call it. But the Cowboys have been productive ever since. And then that sort of hit the skids this year. Kyle talks about the offensive line and its youth. Is there another factor out there that you feel like is primary?
Well, I would probably give the nod to the offensive line too, but you know, I'm just not sure that we have a good idea of how good Dax Garmon is. I mean, we've seen flashes of him being really good, but we've got a mounting you know, resume of evidence that would say he's not as good as he looked early on. So, but I'm with Kyle. I'm just not sure, unless Mason Rudolph is, I know he's more mobile than Dax Garmon, but he's not a guy that you look at and say he's a Johnny Manziel type, I don't think. Maybe I've read that wrong. Maybe he would be that more of that guy, and so that elusiveness could help. But the quarterback question, I think, is a, you know, a really big one, because I'm not really sure that we still have a good idea, even after all these games, of what Dax Garmon really is like. And it'll be interesting to see if he's going to get a chance to show us. Is that offensive line ever going to solidify to the point that, you know, he can show us? I don't know. But I think the other issue, and this is something that Kyle's addressed in some of our OSU update videos, and I know has been talked about in a variety of ways, is Tyreek Hill and his use in the offense. You know, we heard before the season that he was a guy who was going to get a bunch of touches, and obviously some of that comes in special teams and Some of his biggest touches have been in special teams, but, you know, we haven't seen as much of him in the offense. And I think there was a thought that when OSU was going through those rum-dum non-conference games and then early Big 12 play that wasn't great, that maybe they were trying to keep Tyreek Hill a little fresher, not give him as many, you know, punishing hits and tackles, and try to keep him, you know, sort of for the rough stretch to come. We saw him get a few more touches last week, but I think that's an area where they're going to have to figure out a way to get him in space, create some mismatches, and him against anyone in open space is a mismatch in my mind. So if they can figure out a way to get back to how do we get Tyreek Hill 20, 22, maybe 25 touches overall in a game, you know, maybe it transforms the offense, because I like his chances against a lot of defenders in open space.
I like to throw this as an opportunity for OSU, Jenny, right on that point. Guess who's coming to town? The West Virginia Mountaineers. Guess who found ways for a incredible weapon to get a lot of touches? Dana Holgorsen, West Virginia, and Tavon Austin. In fact, we talked a lot about that, wrote about it, whether Tyreek Hill could be another Tavon Austin. I guess this is his chance. Hasn't quite been that kind of player since, although maybe what he was Tavon Austin, who has yet to face the Oklahoma Sooners, Ryan Aber. You were there that night. I'll just reference you on that one. Kyle, let me ask you this question. As you're putting together this story, there's a lot of factors we talked about, sustaining change at quarterback and still producing, sustaining change at offensive lineman, at offensive coordinator. But then along came a news flash this week that OSU and its former offensive line coach are in court about whether he's the play caller at Texas or not. Is it possible that all this offensive woes is just a Joe Wick line? Where have you gone, Joe Wick line?
You know, that's got to factor into it. And you know, I think a lot of the blame for where the offensive line is today, as far as the lack of depth, has to kind of rest on Wickline's shoulders. You know, he was the guy who was a recruiter, and, you know, obviously he had that personality and kind of that vibe across the country as one of the better offensive line coaches out there. But he was also a very harsh disciplinarian. I mean, and I think as what we've seen in social media since this Wickline stuff has come out, you know, former players, you know, Travis Cross and Jake Jenkins have been a little bit vocal about how this, you know, they kind of see this as silly, with Wickline saying, oh, you know, this emotional distress you're causing me. Well, you know, they said they were the ones who had emotional distress after being coached by a guy like that. And so, yeah, obviously you go with that coaching change. You know, Coach Connolly is definitely a lot different style of leadership. The players have said that. So there's going to be that transition period. I don't know if you can blame it on Connolly because of what he inherited coming in. But when you're really trying to transform the culture of a position group, like I think he is, and how he's going to get those guys to perform, there's probably a bit of a learning curve there. And when you have so many young guys who are suddenly switching to a new style of learning, you know, that can't help as far as the track they might have been on before Connolly got there. So you figure another year with him as the coach and another year, you know, with these young guys to progress, it's got to help down the line, but it's not doing any favors right now.
We've had some conversations about stories on Joe Wickline directly, stories on the offensive linemen who have left, John Jenkins, guy Jenny and you have tried to get in touch with. Here's the date, circle it, November 15th, OSU and Texas. Guys, it seems like it's sitting right there on a tee for us to do a big Joe Wickline story and really what's his involvement in this. Jenny, Jason Kersey had a good point, though, about Wickline, which was he had recruited the kind of players that he could coach. And that maybe the new offensive line coach has not yet had a chance to recruit the kind of players he needs to coach. Did OSU get caught in between on this?
Well, I think there's got to be at least a part of the problem that relates back to the recruiting. I mean, Joe Wickline wasn't necessarily a guy that in recruiting went out and got a ton of five-star offensive linemen, and yet they still had really effective offensive lines. You know, obviously Russell Okung developed into a fantastic offensive lineman. They've had several other guys that have made NFL rosters off of Joe Wickline's offensive line. So that clearly the talent was there. But I think Joe brought in guys that were, you know, a certain style. And I think one of the things that he liked was versatility. We saw that play out numerous times as he shuffled offensive line positions, something you so rarely see at that unit where, you know, if a guy is playing a certain spot, unless it's dire, you know, he's not going to move. They're not going to mess with that chemistry. And Joe Wicklund's philosophy was, I want my guys to be able to play every position, essentially, up and down that offensive line. So that's not sort of a normal philosophy for offensive line. And so you have to think what he was looking for in recruiting might be different than what Bob Conley or any other offensive line coach would be looking for. So it'll be interesting to see how that all plays out as Conley goes out and is able to recruit his guys. You know, and I will say this too, you know, we talked about Jake Jenkins. They had a couple guys leave who likely would have been starters. They have potentially the best offensive lineman on campus who's not able to play, Devin Davis, because of that knee injury that he's still trying to recover from, just a catastrophic blowout of his knee before last season. He might have been their best offensive lineman last year, and they had a really good offensive line last year. So, you know, it's interesting that we're talking about the recruiting, because if everything would have held together, if those guys that left or that are unavailable now would be available, we might be saying something completely different about this offensive line, about Bob Conley. But clearly, I think that you have to look at least a little bit at style of players recruited and how that's all playing into this transition time.
Jenny, thanks for referring to Jake Jenkins. You said we talked about him. No, you talked about him. I talked about John Jenkins. So Jake, his name is Jake. Hey, guys, a couple quick questions from the News OK Live page. One is, Kyle, what's happening with Juwan Seals? Will he play Saturday?
I can't imagine that he's going to play. I mean, they've got a deep enough group to where it's not like it's catastrophic if they hold him out. As far as where that case is concerned, I mean, they were arrested and released on bail. As far as anything else that's going to happen legally with the situation, they might have to pay some fines. There might be something else that I'll be following up on. But that'll be pretty much it. Now, as far as Gundy's decision on playing time, you would sure think that this is not going to look good for either of these guys moving forward. You know, with Juwan Offray, it's not as big of an issue, being that so far he's only played reserve in the secondary and then had some special teams time. But let's say that Kevin Peterson gets hurt, then there's a real big question we're going to have there is if Juwan Offray is still in the doghouse at that point. They just don't have very many other options at cornerback, and right now he's the guy who's listed behind Peterson. So that is something to look forward to here is a possible storyline, but I wouldn't expect either of those guys to play this week.
You know, something else I'll throw in there real quick, Mike, before you hop back in. You know, Juwan Seals was one of the Cowboys that Mike Gundy took to Big 12 Media Day, a sign of his status with the program, his seniority, his leadership. Usually those guys are, you know, leaders of the team, leaders of their units, that sort of thing. So in my mind, the fact that he, you know, had this misstep, I think Mike Gundy will, I don't know what he'll do, but I do think that there's a chance that that punishment is, you know, at least a couple games, just from the standpoint of if you've got a leader who's acting like that, I think it sends a bad message to the rest of your team. Now, you know, is this a big offense? I'm not saying that. But when it comes to punishment within the team, it doesn't necessarily have to, you know, be if it's a misdemeanor, it's one game. If it's this, it's that. I think if you've got a guy that they say, hey, guys are looking up to this guy, we expect more out of him, it may be a bigger punishment.
Okay, quick answer from this one, guys. This is not on the News OK Live page, but I think people wonder it. Mason Rudolph, does he play or not on Saturday, Kyle?
I'm going to say no. I don't think there's a whole ton of benefit. Obviously, they'd like to see what he's going to do in a live game situation, but when you consider all the factors of this team, it's not like Dax Garmon has played so terribly that you have to make a change. I mean, the problems in this offense don't start and end with him. It's a number of factors. So you'd like to see Mason Rudolph get playing time, but let's say he goes out there and he gets injured. You know, Mike Gundy isn't going to feel very good about that. And with how many hits that Dax Garmon's already taken with this offensive line and the style of play that they've had, where they've really had to hold a long time for him to kind of have the time to get the ball way downfield with some of those deep passes he's been so successful on, I just don't see it happening. I think at this point, the Cowboys are just going to take their thumps and hope that these guys can get experience for next year.
Of course, this is coming off a report. Bob Berry Jr. on the Sports Animal this week talked about he was hearing Mason Rudolph was taking more snaps, might play. Jenny, does he?
I say no for a lot of the same reasons that Kyle said. You know, if it was a fine-tuned offense, the other 10 guys were playing fantastic, and Dax Garmon was the one hiccup out there, then I'd say absolutely. You pull the red shirt, you try to get this guy ready moving forward, as well as trying to get yourself bowl eligible, which with this run of games is going to be tough. But I think unless Mason Rudolph plays left tackle or center or one of those offensive line positions, I think he stays in red shirt at least for now.
Kyle, stand by for a second. We're going to shift it to the Oklahoma Sooners and their off week and the issues hanging over them, bringing in Ryan Aber. Ryan, the Sooners are coming off that loss to Kansas State, a missed chip shot field goal costing them dearly in that game. But there's also the inability to get yardage in short yardage situations, second straight loss. The Sooners had that happen against a Purple People Eater defense, TCU in one case, Kansas State in the other. And there's a lot of questions hanging around Sooner Nation about what ails them. But finish this sentence for me. Oklahoma would still be unbeaten if only. How do you finish it?
If only Trevor Knight could avoid throwing a bad interception at an awful time. He's done it in both these losses. You've had the pick sixes, the 41-yard interception return by TCU that really got that game going that way, and then really had a really good game against Kansas State, except for the one play that he should have checked out of right near the goal line on the other end that turns into a really easy interception and a touchdown for Kansas State. So there's a lot of things going wrong with this team right now. Nothing really big, but a lot of little things. But that's the one that stands out in both of those games.
After Trevor Knight's great performance in the Sugar Bowl, Jenny, who would have thought he would be we've been lamenting his Tony Romo-like tendencies, sullying a great performance with one bad play. But how do you finish that sentence?
Well, I say, you know, that's obviously a part of it. But two things pop to mind. I don't think this defense is good enough to be a championship team. You know, you go to TCU against a really good defense, and well, they score 31. Am I remembering that number right? You know, they scored a decent amount of points on TCU, but their defense didn't do its job. You know, against K-State, again, a 30-point performance, obviously an offense that, you know, probably did enough to score more but missed those field goals. So, but still, you know, not bad, and yet they just had those moments when they couldn't get off the field on third down. They gave up, I think it was four plays of 38-plus yards against K-State. I mean, K-State's offense had over half of its yards on four plays. So, to me, the defense hasn't lived up to its hype in preseason either, and that's been disappointing. And then I think the other thing I'll say is that they just don't have that mental maturity and focus and sharpness that I think we were told that they would have before this year began. A lot of talk from players and coaches about how mature this group was, and yet you see those little things that are game deciders. Trevor not checking out of that pass play down by the goal line, pick six, you know, perhaps the shortest pick six return ever, 5 yards. I mean, how often do you see a guy catch the ball and essentially find himself in the end zone? Mental mistakes, timeouts having to be called when guys aren't on the field in the right position. To me, that's a sign that some of that sharpness and mental acumen that we thought this team was going to have just isn't there to the level that a championship team needs to have.
Ryan, you guys have written about the defensive shortcomings. You wrote about them this week. However, there's an interesting dynamic going on. We touched on what effect a running quarterback has on the Sooners' aggressiveness. But the Sooners' propensity to give up the big play was on display in the Sugar Bowl. I mean, we saw the big plays that Alabama broke, especially early in the game. But we also saw Eric Stryker draped over A.J. McCarron running around the big offensive tackles. What we have not seen from the Sooners lately, we've seen them giving up the big plays. What's happened to the big plays the Sooner defense was able to create?
Well, I think it's a couple things. The first is the mobile quarterbacks that they're facing. They've had to dial back their aggressiveness a little bit with Eric Stryker and Geno Grissom, especially coming off the edge. And that's because of their tendency to over-pursue and let up big plays in the quarterback run game. The other thing teams are doing is really spreading out their offensive line to really take away that edge for guys like Grissom and Stryker to get a good run at the quarterback. Makes things a whole lot more difficult, and OU still hasn't figured out a way to adjust, which we'll see how much teams do that moving forward because of some of the different styles they're going to face. But at some point, it's going to be an issue again, and Mike Stoops and the defense has to figure out a way to account for that.
That's a really great point, Ryan. A fast, nimble quarterback who can make big plays, and then making guys like Eric Stryker run a lot longer and a lot further distance to get to them if they can get to them. We've seen a chilling effect on the Sooners defense. Jenny, let's go on the other side. The Sooner offense, especially the offensive line. I remember ordering up a story after West Virginia, a game that I only listened to on the radio, but I heard how the sound of the West Virginia announcer's voice, they were getting dejected the way the Sooner offense was pounding the Mountaineers. Really taking their drive out of them. That led to Samaje Perine's big game up there, and we looked at the size of the Sooner offensive line, compared them with NFL lines, and said, who on earth can stand in this unit's way? Well, hadn't been the same since. What happened to that line?
Well, I think teams have decided that they're going to load the box, and instead of trying to have their defensive line handle Oklahoma's offensive line, they're going to throw 7-8 guys at that offensive line in an attempt to make Trevor Knight and his arm beat you. You know, I think it's been pretty well shown that Oklahoma does not want to run Trevor Knight, so he becomes a fairly one-dimensional quarterback. And frankly, I think what Ryan said earlier is spot on. Trevor Knight played fantastically against K-State, with the exception of one play. Threw the ball really, really well, looked comfortable, and, you know, so maybe he's going to have a little bit of a breakout throwing the ball. I don't know. But I think defenses have basically said, you know, we see you, Samaje Perine, and we're not going to let you run us over. We're not going to let Darrell Williams and Ty Darlington and that group dominate us either. We're going to force the passing game to be the thing that wins this game. So now it's not to say that they can't win passing the ball, but it definitely hand ties them a little bit, puts the impetus on probably their weakest offensive unit, being that wide receiver group. But you know, if Trevor Knight can continue to throw it like he threw it against K-State, with the exception of the pick six, maybe they turn a corner and force defenses to soften a little bit, and that opens things up a bit more for Perine.
Ryan, a little bit of this, what I'm hearing is that the opposition is doing things to take away the Sooners' best talents, strong offensive line, aggressiveness on defense. Is there any temptation, or is the answer to say, who cares? We're coming at you anyway. We're going to pound you anyway. Seems like the Sooners may have let these matchups default into taking away their strengths.
Well, I think there's a little bit of that, but also you look at, for instance, the second and short, third and short situation against Kansas State last week. Now, obviously, they're missing Aaron Rutkowski and Blake Bell, who are big parts of that unit that's typically out there, but they still tried to run the ball and didn't have a whole lot of success. I think what they've got to do is show a little bit more of the offense like they did on Saturday against Kansas State. They used Blake Bell over the middle, which we haven't seen a whole lot. They were able to get some other receivers going. I know Sterling Shepard had a huge day, 15 catches, almost 200 yards. But Trevor Knight was able to look off of him at times when he needed to, find those other guys. Micaiah Quick had a really good game, a couple catches, and found his way in the starting lineup. They've got to develop that depth a little bit more there. get big, get bigger numbers out of guys like Quick, out of guys like Bell, out of guys like Daron Neal, and be able to take some of that pressure off the offensive line and Samaje Perine.
The margin is thin. The Sooners have a couple plays away from being undefeated and sitting top of the Big 12 conference, but they're not. Let's bring Kyle back in for an all-skate lightning round. Quick responses on this, guys. The Big 12 football champion will be whom, Kyle?
TCU.
Jenny, who you got?
Well, I've done a lot of study on this, and I'm going to go with West Virginia. I think the Mountaineers can win this thing, guys. Look at their home games here. What they have left, the toughest part of their schedule. TCU comes to West Virginia. K-State comes to West Virginia. They got to navigate at Oklahoma State, at Texas, at Iowa State. I think they're going to get it done.
Kyle, I'll come back to you. I should have given you at least a sentence to explain TCU.
I heard quick fire. So
it
I
was
just,
quick.
I
quicker.
It
How about quicker?
What can I say? I mean, I'll go with TCU just because, I mean, obviously, you know, going against OSU, maybe not the best indicator of how good they are. But my goodness, with that offense, with Trevon Boykin and the things they can do on the ground and through the air, you know, they have a pair of the best defensive tackles in the league just from everyone we've talked to. You know, I think it sets up well for them. Now, West Virginia is going to be tough, and they have to go on the road and go and win in Morgantown. So I think that's going to be a big indicator of how good this team actually is. But then after that, in early November, they get K-State at home. So I think it just sets up well for them, and I've just been impressed with Trevon Boykin.
Holy smokes, Ryan Aber. If Jenny or Kyle are right, that will mean six different conference champions in 6 years. Not good news for the locals, OU and OSU. They would have to be repeat champions. But heck of a lot of good news for college football fans who like surprises. Who you got?
Well, I think it's going to be the winner of the November 8th game at TCU. Kansas State goes in there. I think right now it's going to be TCU. I think their offense with Boykin has been so effective. I really doubted him even just a few weeks ago, even after the OU game. Can he replicate that? Can he, you know, do that week to week? And their offense has proven that it's for real. And I think right now it's the Horned Frogs, which was absolutely shocking to me if I would have thought that before the season.
Guys, another question.
Can we throw out an answer because Jason Kersey isn't here and say it's going to be like three teams at the top? If anybody hates
three,
the one
champions
thing more than Jason, I don't know who it is. So let's say like there's a three-way tie. Let's say it's TCU, Baylor, and West Virginia or something crazy just for Jason.
Jason and I hope for four or five. We want to as many true champions as possible.
Could we do our own Big 12 coverage team commercial in which we all morph into each other and let Jason Kersey
yes.
go one true champion at the end? How about that?
Oh, that's terrifying.
Hey guys, let's cut it down to the big question of the week. Barry Trammell, waxing poetic, his love letter to the West Virginians, the Mountaineers, again in today's paper. An excellent article, I thought, that really did sum up why West Virginia loves Big 12 and back. But I ask you this, Jenny, I'll start with you. Is there a bigger sports crush for Barry Trammell than the Mountaineers?
Oh, my gosh. I don't think so. I mean, who would it be? I mean, maybe he loves the Negro League Museum and Negro League baseball history, but that's not – I mean, obviously that's not happening anymore. No, there's no bigger crush. There's no bigger crush than Mountaineers for Barry. No.
Eugene Linty, DePaul softball coach, the wide streets of Lubbock before they started jacking up the hotel prices.
Yeah.
Any town that's got a Papa Do's.
Jonathan the Mountaineer changed it all. Barry okay. and Jonathan, even though Jonathan's no longer there, the heartstrings are tied deep to Morgantown.
I think the answer, Ryan Aber, Kyle Fredrickson, just look out for it next year when Barry goes back to West Virginia, because he always goes, get him a coonskin cap and let it ride. Maybe he can this thing will work itself out.
Maybe the Mountaineer will let him fire the musket.
Maybe so. Kyle, one question for you and you alone. What's the legacy of the OSU Sports Illustrated report, which was fundamentally unfounded, according to an NCAA and OSU joint investigation this week?
I think the legacy is who cares? I think after this whole thing, we go through all this stuff and all these people are thrown under the bus. And at the end of the day, even with this report that came out that shows that it's fundamentally unfounded, it doesn't really prove anything. Because at the end of the day, with this investigation, there's no paper trail. So if you're going to hang your hat on investigations where you're just going to go off based off what people say and then they retract their statements, it doesn't add up to anything at the end of the day. So I think at least they get a little bit of closure with this latest report that comes out. But it's just this was a weird situation where I think SI wanted to do an expose of everything that was wrong in college football and focus it on one school. And whether or not they had the hard evidence to do it or not, they just kind of pushed ahead and got the interviews and the quotes that they needed to put it together. And it was just a weird situation. So, but when we look back at this situation and everything that's happened, especially with the changes we're about to see in college football down the road with stipends for players and however that's going to work, the culture of college football is changing, and this was an investigation that tried to expose all of that. And at the end of the day, the reaction was kind of meh from everybody. So I think for me personally, that's kind of how I view it.
Finally, for you, Ryan Aber, a little bit of a wild card topic. I didn't tell you this was coming, but the Sooner fans are working through their stages of grief. You can go on News OK right now and look at Jason Kersey, and you guys combined a couple years ago on the Sooner fans' stages of grief. But one that we did not have was transference. In other words, hey, we've got a big problem here, but maybe we could transfer our aggression or thoughts to something else. And along comes the OU band, the pride of Oklahoma, to get everybody's mind off losing at home to Kansas State. Ryan, is there any chance that all this was timed perfectly to get Bob Stoops and the Sooners out of the headlines?
Well, I don't know that anybody timed it like that, but it certainly worked like that. Because people were all fired up about the band after the nasty ads that were taken out in not only our paper, but the Tulsa World and the Norman Transcript and a couple others in Texas. And people did not like the band director, and they went out and got the band director from the previous one, who was at the game on Saturday and actually, I believe, directed at least one of their songs. So that excuse and that focus is going to be gone after this week, though. It's all going to be on the football team to make some changes and turn things around, because there's nothing to hide behind. I don't know if they're going to go create a rowing team controversy or the flag people that are part of the band or whatever. So we'll see what happens.
Maybe we could get them all stirred up again about shouting Sooner during the national anthem. That would take them off the off the hook. Guys, that's all for this edition of Football Friday, but you can stay with the best coverage team every day at News OK and every morning in the Oklahoman.